Hi, this is Dan Chewy Mongrain of Voivod, and you're watching Sonic Perspectives.
Hi, everyone, and welcome to another interview of Sonic Perspectives. I'm Rodrigo, and my guest today is Dan Mongrain from Voivod, otherwise known as CHEWY. Dan, great to have you with us.
Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure.
Yeah, I've been trying to get an interview with you for the longest time, but the schedules never align, so I'm glad we're finally doing this.
All right, cool.
Yeah. And almost 4 years after The Wake, it's time for a follow-up, and the new album is called Synchro Anarchy. I know the writing and recording was completely different this time around, right? Tell us what the process was.
Yeah, well, we got a little bit caught with the situation where we couldn't jam, you know? We couldn't meet, and we have to let go our jam space because we couldn't use it. So at the beginning of maybe the end of 2019, beginning of 2020, I started to write a lot of ideas, but then we lost touch with each other, and I kind of lost interest in working by myself, you know. So we had shows and streaming shows to take care of, and we had to find a way to survive through this. So at some point, you know, the months and years were passing by, and we have to create something, you know. We have to, the clock is ticking, we have to do something. So we kind of agreed to a deadline with the label, and then pressure was on to get on with the whole project. So I suggest the ideas that I recorded a year and a half before, and we started, you know, with share folders to kind of clean up the mess, and a way started to figure out which ideas would go with what, you know, in terms of structures of riffs and songs and stuff like that. And that's not my usual way to work. When I write, I pretty much write from A to Z, you know. I start a song and I finish it. I stopped doing the puzzle thing like 15-20 years ago. I used to do this, you know, have a box with ideas and try to put them together, but this time it was great because a way it helped a lot with structuring ideas that I wouldn't have even never think about. And so we went back and forth, and I organized them in a more precise way, and arranging tonalities, because I said to him, even if the tonalities are not good, you know, the keys changing, I will adapt it. If the ideas are good together rhythmically and it makes sense, I will change the notes so it will work. Right. And then I worked on that. I sent him back. He programmed drums on it. With MIDI, you know, and it sounded just like him. Even though it was programmed, I could feel he was programming exactly how it played it.
Oh, wow.
So I was, then I recorded ghost track, you know, lots of bass track, guitars, everything. And we went to the studio and tried to jam for 2 or 3 days some of the songs. We didn't play all the songs together, just to, you know, and to make Snake sing some lines, some melodies that he will improvise on it, because that's the way we do things usually. It's very organic. So after a while, I came back home. I started to redo all the demos and clicks and ghost track again, so we could go into the studio and complete the album one by one. At first, we wanted really to play together in the studio, like we did for the EP, Post Society.
We
played together, you know, and recorded the performance. That's what we aimed to do, but it was impossible in this situation. So we ended up working in the studio very, very intensely for a short period of time to write, demo, and record and mix the album, which had the quality to be spontaneous, and in a kind of emergency state, that kind of a survival state that you have to be on 24/7, you know, and your imagination is going crazy, you know.
So right.
It was very tough, but I think it came out good.
Yeah, and I think the name Synchro Anarchy kind of reflects the recording process. It also reflects the state of the world today with everyone stuck at home, but a lot of confusion and anxiety at the same time, right?
That's totally true. And, you know, I just realized that by you saying it, that's exactly what was going on in the studio. And that's, you know, most of music an artist is created is autobiographic, even though we don't know about it. It is biographic, and that's totally true. Totally.
Yeah. There you go. Unintentionally so, but that's how it came out. Yeah.
Yes.
And I spoke with Snake in December 2020, I think, when the Lost Machine Live came out. And I asked him if you guys were writing a darker material because of all the frustration with COVID, isolation, and so on. He said he wanted to write something positive, but I guess that plan was abandoned because there's a lot of dark themes throughout the album, right?
That's true. I agree with you. It's a dark album, I think.
Yeah.
But there is glimpses of hope. There is some light, some hope. There's always hope.
Yeah.
And I think there's a depth to the album. I think Snake is a very emotional person. And he digs deep into himself to write stuff. Mm. And it really shows on this album. You know, there's fiction, there's stories, but there's something in the core of all that that's really, really true and genuine. And he's someone that feels deeply. He's affected by what's going on around him and the whole planet going crazy right now. So.
Yeah,
I think we can feel it through the lyrics, through the music. But like the world today, I think it's that one that, you know, just it's just free to smile at someone, you know, and it makes someone happy. Just be a good, try to be a good person and good to each other. So there's positivity through the album, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And I can tell that, I don't know, maybe it's my perception, but he seems to be adding, you know, not just the sci-fi elements, but a little bit of social commentary in the recent albums, at least from post-society onwards, I guess that was his trend sort of thing.
Yes. Yeah. And sometimes it's easier to go through science fiction to point that out because you don't aim at a country or a type of person, or it's nothing direct. And it's not like moralist, it's not the paternalist or anything like that. It's just expressing ourselves. How do we feel in this situation or this era that we're living in? And this is happening, and this is happening. But going through fiction is indirect, and I think opens the door for more soulful thinking and reflection, so to speak.
Yeah. And one thing that always struck me as, incredible and odd is how unpredictable the vocals are. For example, on Planet Eaters, they're like more buildings to build, that kind of thing. You know, if I had to sing a song by Voivod, like without being a fan for so long, I'm always scratching my head about when the vocals start, when the chorus kicks in. How does that come into play in the writing process? Because for him, it must be difficult too, right?
Yes, I mean, Snake always sang in Voivod. He had a couple of other bands, but he grew up singing in Voivod. He was like 18, 19 year old when he started. So he always was in this kind of hostile, harmonic, dissonant, weird, thrash, punk, prog structures and all the weird piggies chord and you know, so he feels like home, like when something like that happens. And he always, like, when he's got his mic and we were playing the riffs and he started there's no word, it's just trying something, and sometimes the melody pops up,
right.
And it's exactly what you're hearing on the record. He has this talent of almost writing a childish melody, something that you can remember right away, very simple, but on a really strange environment.
Yeah.
Very chaotic chords and structures. So it amazed me every time. I don't know anybody on earth able to pull that off.
Me neither. And there are certain bands, not just Voivod. For example, one other example comes to mind, Marillion, for example, in the Fish era. Fish's vocals, you never know when it's going to come in. Even Rush on certain songs, yeah. You're like, where does it fit in, you know? Yeah.
And then you hear it and it makes sense.
It does. You know? Yeah.
And that's really, he brings a lot to the music.
Mm-hmm.
When Snake comes in, the song is taking another dimension. It's going elsewhere. So sometimes I have to readapt some of the guitar and bass dialogue and the ideas, because his melody is so strong that we want to keep it.
Right.
So that's the teamwork process.
Which awesome.
Is interesting. Yeah.
Yeah. One of my favorite songs is Quest for Nothing, where I think you're playing a mandolin towards the end. Yeah. From memory, that's the first time a Voivod song has a mandolin, right?
I think so. I think there was maybe 12 strings on some of the Piggy's song era. He had an electric 12 string on Nothing Face. I think as far as acoustic, maybe some of the intro outro on some albums, but this one was the first. I played a mandola and a mandolin,
okay,
so, double each one of them, so there's an octave going on, and I had to tune it in a different strange way so it fits the line. But I play some acoustic guitar on that outro too, both at the same time. So when it fades out, you can hear the acoustic stuff.
Awesome.
I think it brings another dimension in that part, which was kind of epic, grandiose outro of the song.
Oh yeah, it's almost like it turns into a different song towards the end, just because of that. Yeah, yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, and I love the time shifts of the title track, and the solo you did for it is crazy as well. What kind of effect did you use on that one?
On Synchro Anarchy?
Yeah.
No effect, my friend.
Really?
Yes, only like a reverb or a delay, but nothing special. What I did is I played with... I thought the mood of the song... I don't know. Usually I go for, you know, some kind of soloing, a bit of fast notes here and there, you know, like a rock guitar solo. But on this one, I started to play with my vibrato bar and reach microtones, so notes that are not on the piano, but in between the notes of the piano. So it's really, really awkward feel. It feels really awkward because it's not on the temperament of the song at all. It doesn't exist. It's like playing on the wrong part of the violin or or a slide guitar or a fretless, really. So I played this simple melody, but kind of strange melody, and bend the notes with the tremolo so it goes out of tune. And in and out and in, like this. Because it creates this tension and this kind of, you don't want to be in the room, you know?
Right.
Think to that.
It's almost like they're clashing against each other, right?
Totally.
Yeah. Yeah.
But it's controlled. It's all played with control, and that's what my intention was, playing that way for that song.
Mm-hmm.
And it's the only solo that sounds like that. I think it's the first time I play like that ever.
Right. Yeah. And like, I've seen your YouTube channel. You play a lot of cool stuff. The solos from Beat It and City Nights from Alan Holdsworth. I mean, you're wearing a Jason Becker t-shirt. You're a pretty melodic guy. At the same time, the Voivod songs you write are full of dissonance. Do you have to be in a specific frame of mind to write that type of song or not? Or does that come naturally? Or
well, as a Voivod fan since an early age, I started to understand this language early on. So for me to speak the language is maybe more easy than other musicians that got into it later in life.
Right.
So for me, it's not a big struggle to write that kind of music. And I wrote extreme metal before with a lot of dissonance and odd time signature, because Voivod was one of my main influence as a death metal musician, if I can say a genre, but the complexity, the dissonance, and the odd time signature and the strange structures always been part of my vocabulary. For Voivod, I kind of changed my approach because I don't play the same way. It's a three-piece musician. I mean, four-piece with the singer, but so there's a lot of dialogue going on with the bass and guitars. Sometimes the bass has to act like a second guitar or a baritone guitar, and sometimes it has to act like a bass. Sometimes I have to play like a keyboard player.
Yeah.
Just playing chords and voicing that will ring and bring a color to the landscape so the singer can have a floor to sing over, you know, something solid. So, and sometimes I play riffing, like just usual, well, riff, metal riff part with strange notes. And so it's, I think, I don't try to think too much about it. I just try to, I never write with a guitar in hand. I write listening into my music self.
Okay.
And when an idea is popping and it takes form, then I pick up the guitar and I translate it into the strings and neck and distortion.
Okay. And so when you first started writing for Voivod, like unique material, I think it was on Target Earth.
Yes.
Was there a level of apprehension about how the material will be received, or if you guys could pull it off without Piggy and continue with the band or not?
It was at the beginning of this process, it was pretty stressful. It started at first with some of the material of the original bass player, Blackie. He had bass lines, you know, and I started to put some landscape over it. And then we played it into the tour bus, and Away and Snake heard it, and they were wondering what was going on. And it ended up, you know, developing into what was Target Earth, and we worked together and all that. At that point, I was stressed out by, you know, it has to sound like Piggy, it has to sound like Voivod. But at a certain point, when we started to jam together, I realized that the guys didn't expect anything, or they didn't put pressure on me to sound like. And at the same time, you know, as soon as I know my Voivod, I've done my research, and we toured for 5 years before that.
Right.
So I was, you know, I was into this kind of universe anyway. So when I started to write and do my own riffs and my own composition on that album, like Mechanical Mind is pretty much from start to finish my material. So and as soon as Snake and the way started to play and sing, it sounded like a Voivod song, you
right.
know?
Yeah.
So at some point the stress went down and I just started to feel more free and spontaneous and just true to myself, instead of trying to be someone that I'm not. Using what I have as an influence from what was before and everything that I've experienced in life to express myself through music in the Voivod flying saucer.
Right. That's a good way of putting it. Yeah. And I'm glad that the fans embraced it. And I think Voivod is a band with zero casual fans. I don't know if you have the same perception or not, but that's how I see it. How do you explain that?
I think Voivod is a very, as a fan, not as a member as well, I'm both. I'm a fan of what was before me. And I think Voivod is so unique and strange, and when you understand it, you cannot let go of it.
Yeah.
It's a love or hate, maybe an extreme kind of band, but if you understand and love it, you kind of dedicated, loyal, and you kind of, it's a universe, it's another dimension. It's precious. it's fragile. It's a family. It's something very unique. I guess you understand what.
Absolutely.
Yes. Yeah.
I still question myself. You know, how can some like a material that's this abrasive to the ears? You know, I'm so drawn to it. But you know, I like it. I just can't explain.
It's for sure an acquired taste.
Yeah.
It takes time sometimes to get it. Sometimes people doesn't have the patience to go over that wall. But once you go over it, you there's no turning back. And yes, you are totally right. Voivod fans are really special and unique, and they kind of recognize their own uniqueness through the uniqueness of the band. And when we travel and we meet everybody, the connection is pretty fast because we kind of understand. I don't know. There's a lot of people that went through tough times in their life, in their own country, in social situations, but they were listening to the band, and they have these memories that helped them through tough times, or you know they don't. Some of the fans are a little bit like misfits or outcasts, you know, from a majority, and they see themselves and they recognize themselves in the connection of all the Voivod family. So I think it's a great medium. Music is a great medium for that, you know.
Yeah, yeah. And tell me about your partnership with Bond Instruments. Your guitar has a very unique shape, and it seems to be very light as well. Can you tell me about how you did some input into that?
Well, Louis-Philippe Bond was in the 90s, late 90s, was a student, guitar student of mine. He would drive 2 hours and come to my place. And
wow.
I would give him lessons. I think I was still living at my mother's place at the time. Like, it's a long time ago. Mm. And he really was a fan of Martyr, my previous band. And so at some point we lose contact. And decades later, I heard he was. We met again in a band competition or something nonsense like that. And he had the guitars that he made, and he said, "Hi, do you want me to? Maybe we can work on a guitar together." And yeah, let's check it out, you know. And so we designed together this unique CHEWY signature guitar. And so I've learned a lot through him of what I want, what I do not want on a guitar. And we did some tests, and we built one. We then built another one, and every one of them is better for me. I know what I want more and more. And now he's building me a Strat.
Oh, cool.
Very nice wood. Again, he's got great choices of wood, and it's his strength, really. And so we have a good relationship, and we try to develop his product and promote it, because it's great to have artists making a very precise instrument for yourself, you know, with every guitar player has different needs and different preferences. So to have someone who takes care of every little details is really good.
Absolutely. Yeah. And you mentioned Martyr, your previous band, which has been on hiatus since 2012. Are there any plans to release a new album? I mean, the old material is still available on your website, right?
Yes, I may, if I have time, when I have time, I will put out the tab books again.
Okay.
Maybe print some merch, I don't know yet. I have to prioritize Voivod, and I'm teaching a lot, and I play in other bands as well as a freelance musician in Montreal, so in the province. So I'm very busy at the moment, but it's unlikely that we will do something again. It's been a very long time. Everybody got his life and is busy. And it's not really something that I'm looking to forward to. I never say never, but right now it doesn't seem to go in that direction. So,
fair enough. Well, back to Voivod then. I know you did a few live streams playing Nothing Face and Dimension Hatros in full. Would you guys consider doing something like The Outer Limits in full, or even The Wake, which was fantastic? And you know,
thanks.
I rather listen to The Wake in full as opposed to standalone tracks. But would you guys consider that?
It's really something that we consider to do one or two or numerous events like that. Mm. And I think it's really special to play a whole album. It's a lot of work, though. It's really a lot of work because we're not touring right now. I don't know when we're going to tour. So learning a bunch of songs and nail them and practice, it takes time. It takes effort to play it. Only once, it's kind of frustrating in a way. But we really want to give the fans something like that again, available, and we will probably make the other streaming shows available through the website. Soon. So we'll do something with it for sure. But in the meantime, we talked about doing other streaming shows like that, and I think it's gonna happen.
Okay. Fingers crossed. Yes. What's the talk with promoters at this point? I believe, at least here in Ontario, where I am, the restrictions will be will be lifted in March, I believe. So.
Yes, it's hard. It's really hard to predict. I see on the websites a lot of bands are canceling or postpone their tour again.
Yeah.
It's the same for us. We waited to announce tours and then we couldn't announce it because it was postponed. So we're happy that we didn't announce this. You know, there's less deception and all that, but it's a nightmare for bookers and agencies and venues and bands.
Yeah.
I don't know what to answer. You know, we don't know much more, but we hope to play, you know. At this point, I think if you're in the UK and you stay in the UK, you can tour in the UK.
Yeah.
But when we tour, we play 4 shows in the UK. So to take a flight and a tour bus and a crew to go there to play 4 shows is impossible.
Yeah.
Financially. So we cannot do that. Maybe in the United States it's easier because the rules are
more flexible.
More flexible. Mm-hmm. Then people get sick, so I don't know.
Yeah,
I can't answer that.
Yeah, we'll see. Like I'm seeing my friends watching shows in the US and going to concerts and whatnot. I'm like, when will I be able to see them? It's been 2 years, but
it's frustrating. Yeah. Totally frustrating, and especially for musicians. That, you know, I'm lucky because I'm teaching music online, I'm teaching in college, and I make a living out of music anyway, no matter what happens. That was one of my main goals in life was no matter what happens, I will survive with music. And I'm lucky and I'm grateful. But a lot of my friends and a lot of colleagues struggle right now because they can't play. And it's a nightmare, really. It's really, really bad.
Yeah. Well, I hope you guys get to tour extensively at some point to promote this album. I saw you guys twice here in Toronto with Amenra once, and I think Revocation on the second time, but always opening the show. I'd love to catch you guys headlining at some point. So
we like direct support.
Yeah. Yeah.
Finish earlier and take showers.
There you go.
But you're right. It's good to be headlining and play a full set. I like it.
We'll see. Yeah. Well, I'll keep my fingers crossed, man. For now, I'd like to thank you for so many years of great music and wish you all the best with Synchro Anarchy.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me. It's a pleasure, Rodrigo.
Likewise. We'll be in touch. Cheers.
All right. Cheers.
Bye.